I was sitting in our living room, my mother and sister-in-law, one late afternoon as they were preparing to make dinner. And they recounted to me their experiences of what happened when four agents showed up at our house. My sister-in-law, Dina, wearing an orange white shalwar kameez, anxiously began to tell me, "I was frightened when I heard them stomping on the stairs as if an army was marching toward our home. I glided up from the basement and saw four people were at the door and black cars parked on our driveway. My mother, who was resting next to me on the pastel green white checkered print sofa, rose up and, approaching the entrance door, exclaimed, "Shondi!" When I opened the door like this, the agents stampeded in the living room, demanding to know who is Shirin Sadeki, that they were going to arrest me for an immigration violation. They strolled in here as if they owned the house, pacing toward the middle of the room. They came in like within 5 minutes after Sonali left. It's like maybe they were waiting for her to leave, because they knew we don't speak English and she does. Amma, my mother, was wearing a blue white striped apron over black fleece pants and a white sweater. As she spoke, her movements and gestures were marked with distress, which accentuated the passage of time in her appearance. In a quivering voice, Amma continued, "I kept calling on Allah and saw the man questioning me. He was very tall and big, and in a blank look which shivered me, I identified myself saying, 'I am Shirin Sadeki.' Ascending, they encroached upon me, pushing me toward the center of the room, saying they came to arrest me. I became confused and terrified, not understanding why they were saying this to me. And I said, 'I need to call my children and tell them I'm going with you.' But one female agent replied that she was angry at me. 'You can't call them right now. You have to go with us immediately.' My heart dropped, and she told me this. When she told me this, and I don't know what I felt, but I feared they were going to take me away and I would never see my children. Then I told them I need to change my clothes in the other room, and the female agent followed me. The living room we all gathered in had a large, uncurtained window on the front porch, which oversaw our driveway and the street outside. The walls were adorned with framed photos of famous Islamic symbols, holy mosques and shrines of Mecca and Medina. The brick mantle over the fireplace included photos of my father shaking hands with the former Speaker of the House, Newt Gingrich, and the former Vice President of the World Bank. The photos prominently appeared out at the room. Recording these elements of our room, I keep thinking, why hasn't my family removed these photos from here? When my mother traded back to the center of the room, I probed her, "Amma, how did you feel when the agent followed you? What were you thinking?" Breaking into a perturbed voice, she expressed, "The agents were big, they were tall, like 6 feet, taller than your Abba, and the females were like Sonali's what, like 5'6", right? They were dressed in dark suit and tie, like they were normal people going to work, and it was like they owned our home. And when the female agent followed me, she kept asking me if I had a gun in my room. I said no. Then she asked me again whether we had a gun in our home, and my heart kept trembling. I tried to shut the closet door to fix my clothes, but she commanded me to leave it open. I wasn't wearing a hijab, and I felt uneasy in the way she was glaring at me, and I kept calling Allah to keep me safe, to keep my children safe. And I was reciting, 'La ilaha illa anta subhanaka inni kuntu min al-zalimin.' My mother was reciting the prayer of Jonah, a special supplication, evoking God for protection from danger and harm. When Jonah read when he was in the belly of the fish, as the women described their experiences to me in Bengali, I was transcribing the responses in English. I could feel their trepidation on my fingertips, intensified in my mother's recitation of the prayer of the prophet Jonah. The episode took place on December 8, 2005, 4 months after my mother Shifa left for Bangladesh to get married, when four immigration aid law enforcement agents stormed into our quiet suburban Roswell, Georgia home shortly after my sister, Sonali, a community organizer, left for work. But I was recording it during my winter break 2 weeks after the incident. As my mother and I were conversing, Dina, my sister-in-law, who was swinging between the kitchen and the living room, interjected. "Yes, when she went to the bedroom, the other agent who was with me in his living room, he flaunted his gun from the side jacket pocket, gesturing with his eyes like this." She mimics the agent's facial features. "And he asked me, chillingly, 'Do you have this in your home?' I thought he was going to do something to me, and I was making dua for protection. 'No, we don't have this in our home,' I told him, and he kept staring at me. Then I saw the other agents meander through the entire floor looking for something. pointing to different directions, Dina heatedly continued to tell me how the agents penetrated every corner of our home, appearing to be searching for something valuable, but she didn't know what. The agents had persuaded Dina to go with them. When she refused, they instructed my mother to take Dina with her for support. My mother continues to tell me, when I asked for clarification, fluctuating between pauses and silence, my mother revealed, when Dina and I stepped out of the porch, I tried to lock the door, but the male agent was questioning me. He pushed us out to go to the car, saying he would lock it, but I don't know if he locked it or not, because after we left, they stopped at a gas station and made some phone calls. We were riding in two separate cars. I was scared because I didn't know whether they were taking us both to the same place or different places, and I felt helpless not having Dina with me. And I didn't understand all the things they were asking me. I kept reciting Ru'ah. I didn't know where they were taking me and if I would see my children again. I went inside because I had heard so many bad things happening to people. I didn't know what was going to happen to me, but I remained quiet and prayed to Allah to keep my children safe. At the immigration office, the inspector reminded my mother that she was under arrest and would go to jail if she did not comply. He threw before her what appeared to my mother like a 30-pound pile of paper. After a short inquiry about her immigration, he questioned her about my brother Shifa. Traumatized and confused after 2.5 hours of interrogation without an interpreter and his questions unrelated to immigration, the agent coerced my mother to sign this and that paper before informing her that she had been placed on deportation proceeding. The immigration prosecutor admitted to my mother's lawyer a year later how they usually did not pursue such minor violations but had instruction from Washington to prosecute her to derive information about her family. Since this assault on her, my mother has been battling with the byproduct of preventive prosecution of my brother and struggling to stay in the country. This was the day the FBI raided our unlocked home to search and seize, which we later found out from my brother's lawyers. This was how the FBI and other agents terrorized my family members to manufacture a case against my brother Shifa, questioning so many people who were related and unrelated to us and people whom my brother never met.